our neighbors, our family members who are living in poverty with little to no hope of moving above the federal poverty line, legitimately. And it's because of the laws that are in place now are designed to keep us there. Last year I had a model, and I'm carrying it into this year. The cavalry ain't coming. Nobody's gonna come charging over the hill, blowing a trumpet, to help us. It's up to us. We on our own. We have to understand that only legislation can be changed when people stand up and demand what they want. Communities only get better when people in the community decide to make it better. The education of our children only gets better when the parents of those children decide to make it better. It's on us. I'm happy with this answer. I'm a bit disheartened, but that's not what I'm looking for. What is important is that you are here. See, I've come through a progression of life. Life has continued. And hopefully, you learn some new things, and you retain those things, and then you act upon those things. So, for those of you who don't know, I've not always been the person that would get a standing ovation. I was the person that was told to get off the bus, because I was stinking. I'm the person that lived in a vacant building and slept on cardboard. I'm the person who had that child that God spoke about taken from me, and I had to work to get him back. See, life is a continuum. We go through things. But when you go through, you come out on the other side of that person. You should. So, what I'm saying to you is, everything in life as a spiritual nature, I've come to realize. So this rally, don't give me credit. It wasn't my idea. I can't tell you something like this. The idea was placed in my spirit. And then because I have free will, I decided to be obedient and see what I could do. And as I move forward, things fell into place because that's what he wanted me to do. But see, we get those decisions every day. You know, you don't have the thought of your own. Whether that thought is to get out of bed in the morning or lay a little bit longer, that free will makes you decide what you want to do. But the thought will wasn't yours. The thought to get up, we know where that came from because he wants you to use his time, productively. But then you got that free will thing going on. I'm a girl, but this day started. I got stuff to do. I'm a lady. That's something. It's about free will and obedience. That's why it's right to say. But most importantly, in a practical sense, everybody here in this room is here because they are concerned about how a criminal record is holding them back, a loved one back, someone that they care about, and keeping the community at large tied down. So, Indianapolis this year, this is the meat of why we're here. Indianapolis this year, there are 7 bills dealing with extortion. 7. And they're all over the place. So to put that in context, last year, and the year before that, and the year before that, there was just 1 bill. But see, this is an election year. People want to get their name out there. Look what I'm doing for the community, not people. But you haven't been trying to do that up till now. So this is to bring clarity and understanding and let you know what is best and what we need to put our support on. So hopefully everyone got some paperwork from our assistants in the back. It has a list of bills on it. On the reverse side, it has contact information for the committee members that will be hearing those bills, that people will be testifying to. So for those of you who don't know, may not remember, let me give you a quick refresher. In the state of Maryland, I like it. A friend of mine says I like to teach. I don't know about that. That's the same thing. In the state of Maryland, long ago, after they came and jumped off that boat and landed on the rock, the King of England said, I need somebody to run this province. And we got somebody named Cowper. He was the de facto king. He's a mini king. What he said goes, he made the rules. So he carried those rules from England. And in England, if you got caught stealing a ball from the shopkeeper, a wooden ball from the shopkeeper, or you ran on somebody's farm and took a hen, the chicken from you don't eat. And you got caught, they would drag you down to the town square, stick you in that thing. I used to think it's called a socks, but I learned that it's not, it's called a pillow. And they would stick you in the pillow. And you went on town square. So everybody could see who you are and know what you did. It's still the same thing. The pillory today is the internet. The Maryland Judiciary King Service website is the modern pillory. Because everything and anything that's done in the courtroom goes on their website. So people can pull your name, see who you are, know what you did. Same thing. It hasn't changed. Same principle. You can go to any courtroom in the state and sit in that courtroom and find out who's going home, who's going to jail, what they did, how they did. Same principle. So expungement is removing that information from the public view. The files are shredded, documents are deleted, it's gone. The problem with expungement is the legislators don't like it because the information is gone. Yeah, they can't go back and see what's going on. So this year and last year, a bill was introduced to shield a record. The difference is with shielding, the record is still there, but only the courts can see it. The attorneys, the judges, people involved in the process. So when you go look for a job, the employer can't see it. When you go look for housing, the landlord can't see it. The record is shielded. Now, if that employer has a statutory and legal requirement to see certain things, that's what they can see. So if you're trying to get a job with a bank or a financial institution and you have theft charges, investment charges, that employer can see those things, but can't see anything else. If there is no statutory requirement, then that employer can't see anything. Unless it's something that the shielding bill does not cover, like sex offenses, murder, heinous crimes. So the shielding legislation is a good idea. However, when the people in Annapolis make our laws for us, they very rarely come to us and say, what do you want? How do you think we should make this bill so it can become a law? Everybody here remember, I'm just a bill sitting on Capitol Hill? A bill is what's drafted, and they vote on it and decide if that's going to become a law. But bills really come from people. We come up with the idea, tell them to make a bill. That's how it starts. But see, sometimes they think they do it, and they draft a bill and pass it in a law. And we'd be like, what the heck is that? Who came up with that idea? So, the point of this is to tell them what we want, what we need, because the shielding bill only deals with misdemeanors, period. So if you're convicted of a felony, if you got a felony on your record, this shielding bill is not going to help you in the least, be right where you are now. Stop. There's no mention of the word felony anywhere in this bill. So who is the service? The proof that it's serving the people in Annapolis who broke the bill, because they get to say, I got a bill passed. It became a law with my name on it, and it's helping these people, but truly it's not really helping these people. So we got to tell them, that's not what we're looking for. I don't know who you were talking to, but you didn't come talk to me. You didn't talk to my cousin. Who did you talk to? Each other. And they didn't do a good job of that because they got 7 bills. They couldn't sit down in a room and say, look, we need to do something about this community thing. We got too many people that's being held back. Let's put our heads together. No, that's too much like right. Every man for himself. They took a crab pot to a mattress. And y'all know what I'm talking about. So we have to tell them what it is we want. Senator Joan Carter Conway drafted a bill that will help people with misdemeanors and felonies. But again, they didn't talk to each other. So her name is the only one that did it. She's doing it all by herself. She's the main sponsor, no co-sponsor. But that's really the best piece of legislation being proposed. Then we've got another one. They're calling it the Second Chance Act of Maryland. But that's the one that doesn't have anybody with felonies, so it's not really the second chance. Half a chance for a certain amount of people. But it's got a gaggle of co-sponsors. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. And the list goes over. 20 of them think this is a good bill, but they haven't talked to anybody. They didn't ask nobody. But because it has the most co-sponsors, it will probably be the bill that is made into a law. No help for anybody with a felony. So how do you do something about that? That's the fun part. Okay, we've got one child on the board. So one is enough. I gotta watch my mind. When I was young, I would hear the people in my family, the elder people in my family, they see me looking at the kitchen table or looking at the dining room table during dinner time. And they could tell that you wanted something. But they wouldn't move on it, they wouldn't act on it, until you spoke the heck up and told them what you wanted. Can you pass me this stranger? Can I have a role? You don't speak up, you're not going to get nothing. That's how life is. That's what they were training me at the dining room table. If you don't speak up, you're going to get what you got. It's going to stay the same. So, at one point in time, we did speak up.